Good morning, guys. Welcome to the Bitcoin Family YouTube channel. For the newcomers, my name is Didi Taihutu. Yes, I am the guy that 3 years ago sold everything he owned, his house, his companies, his bikes, his cars, my kids' toys, my wife's shoes, everything as a family. We went all into Bitcoin and started traveling the world. We were featured in CNBC, Wall Street Journal, Channel News Asia, and many more platforms, guys, because it was a crazy step in the life that led to the Bitcoin family. Now, 3 years later, we are still traveling the world as a family, coming to you guys today from Koh Phangan in Thailand. Soon, we will leave Koh Phangan to go to Europe again and travel around Europe to meet all these projects and discover how cryptocurrency is doing in all European countries. In today's video, we are going to talk about the Bitcoin price. We are going to show you how Bitcoin is outperforming other assets. I'm going to show you the difference between the DeFi industry and stable currencies and Bitcoin. I'm going to talk to you about fungible and non-fungible tokens and try to educate you a little bit so you understand what is going on in this industry. And yes, by looking at the charts, guys, I'm going to show you if we are in the bear trend or in the bull trend. And yes, also educate you on the difference between a bear trend and a bull trend and how we can see if we did start a bull trend. I hope you enjoy today's video, guys. Let's take a jump into my office. Ooh, yes, a bigger jump, a different entrance to my office. But this one is exact up front of my door. I am going to try and walk to the right side again on the beach today. Yes, again, not a beautiful, amazing, unique location here in Koh Phangan. The last couple of days have been busy, busy, busy. Today, again, a busy day. You can imagine we are leaving Tuesday, so we are saying goodbye to all our friends, to all the projects I've been supporting. So everybody is inviting me over for some podcast or YouTube show, and we are doing dinners, all this stuff. So I'm very sorry that I cannot show you these unique places. I will try to show you one more unique place before I leave this amazing island here on Koh Phangan, Thailand. Let's get to the news, guys. Bitcoin can never go to zero again because Alistair Milne put in a buy order at $0.01 to buy all the Bitcoins when the Bitcoin price ever drops to $1. You might think, everybody can do this. Yes, of course, everybody can do this. But if you put on a buy order for all the Bitcoins at $1, you still need to put in $185,000 buy order. So if you put in this buy order of $185,000, you cannot use this anymore for something else. I think it's still cool that he did it because, you know, he kind of froze his own money to save Bitcoin. Thumbs up, Alistair Milne. Bitcoin can never go to zero again. There was another record made in the Bitcoin industry. Yes, the biggest amount of Bitcoins have been withdrawn from Coinbase exchange. More than 20,000 Bitcoins withdrawn on the 8th of July. To be exact, 20,660 Bitcoins have been withdrawn from Coinbase on the 8th of July. This is a new all-time high of withdrawals from Coinbase. I think it's very positive because people don't want to sell their Bitcoins. They are withdrawing them probably into their hardware wallets to keep them for the next bull run. So bullish sign to me. If people withdraw their Bitcoins in these big amounts from the exchanges, I think it's a bullish sign. If we look at BTC as an asset, it's still one of the best performing assets of this year. If you look at the year-to-day result, which means starting in January, ending of today, Bitcoin is still outperforming many other assets. Bitcoin at the moment is at a 28.2% return on investment, which is really good. Second place, guys, is taken by gold, 18.5% return on investment, which is also still good, but not as good as Bitcoin. SPX, that didn't do that well. It's minus 1.5%, so. And if you invested in dollar, your capital also increased with 4.79%. But still, this is all nothing compared to the 28% Bitcoin has shown us this year again. So again, Bitcoin is proving now in the first and the second quarter that it is the best performing asset out there to invest in, guys. A lot of people keep asking me, Didi, what is now bear trend and what is now the bull trend, and when can we see that we reach a new bull trend and that we leave the bear trend? So bear trend is when we are going downwards. So that means we are making lower highs every time and lower lows every time. Then you definitely know that we are in a bear trend. The bear trend is called a bear trend because when a bear attacks, it attacks from up downwards, like the claw, like this is a bear trend. Then when we go to a bull trend, why is it referred to as a bull trend? Because the bull trend, the bull attacks from downwards upwards. The bull horns you whop, upwards like this. Like in Spain, you know, the toreadors with the beautiful red flags, the bull always goes up. That's a bull trend. Some information for the ones that didn't know it yet. We know for sure that there is a bull trend if we see higher highs and higher lows. And if I need to be very honest, if you look at the monthly chart, we are still in a bear trend. The biggest top we had was 20k, then we went to 14k, then we went to 10,600, and we didn't pass 10,600 till now. So this means we still are in this long-term bear trend. Also, when you look at the weekly chart, you get the same image. It's long on the weekly and the monthly chart. We are not making a higher high, so closing a weekly or a monthly candle above 10,600, we are still in a bear trend. And the moment we break 10,600 and close a candle above 10,600 on the weekly or the monthly chart, we are, in my opinion, in a real bull trend. There are many positive indicators at the moment that are telling us that we are going to try and test the 10,500 region again and maybe break it and take it up to 11,600, which would mean we could close the candle above 10,600. And if we close this candle above, we can slowly start to call this a Bitcoin bull trend. Guys, I need to cross this bridge again. I've done it a few times before, as you remember. This time I walk across the pillars. Emotionally, we can say we already are in this bull trend because we all feel that Bitcoin is going up. And if you zoom out really big and you look at the stock to the flow chart, we have been in the bull trend for the last 11 years. You know, we started at 7 cents or something like this, and we are now at $10,000 almost. So the further you zoom out, the more you will see we are continuously in a bull trend. For example, check this chart. In this chart, you can see the 2016 to 2018 uprun. This is the bull run. Then from the top of 20K downwards all the way to $3,000, this was the bearish run. Then we got a small bull run up to 14K, which was a bull run, higher highs, higher lows. And then we got another correction, a bear run, all the way down again to $3,000 in the beginning of this year, which was the bear run. Now, we are starting to make this new bull run, but we need to create higher highs. We need to close the candle above 10,600, and then if we close the candle above 14,000, then we are definitely in a long-term bull run as well, because then we even crossed the level of 14K, which was the high of the last bull run. When it comes to the Bitcoin price, I am still expecting the same, like I already said. I think we are going to test the 10,500 huge resistance level. I hope we will break it and then take it all the way up to 11,600, and you know, and make a new high over there. Maybe then get a correction and take it up a little bit higher again, or maybe even go sideways again so that all the alts will come up again and make these huge returns on investment that we have been seeing now lately in Dogecoin. 150%, and many other currencies outperform Bitcoin. So this is a small alt season, but if you compare it to the 2017 alt season, are we still far away? Because in that year, 2017, altcoins were performing like with 300% increases a day, 400% increases a day. So yes, this is already a little bit start of an alt season, but I think bigger alt season still needs to start. I needed to explain to a friend yesterday how that this whole market moves. As far as my knowledge goes, guys, I always have this rule in my head. The only moment that altcoins are going up for an alt season is when Bitcoin goes sideways. So every time that Bitcoin goes sideways for a longer period, like we are doing now, many weeks, 8K, 10K, 8K, 10, all this table tennis game, as long Bitcoin is doing this, altcoins have the possibility of going up. The moment you see Bitcoin starting to run, you will see again that people will exchange their altcoins into Bitcoin. So less demand for altcoins, decrease of the altcoin price. More demand for Bitcoin, increase of the Bitcoin price. This is how the whole industry works. It's a very simple rule. Just always watch Bitcoin. Bitcoin going up, altcoins will go down. Bitcoin going down, altcoins will go down. Bitcoin going sideways, altcoins can climb up. A very important thing I want to talk to you guys about is this whole DeFi industry. I think DeFi is this new magical word in the crypto industry, but I don't really love DeFi. Yes, I understand DeFi, and I like that DeFi is making it able to have stable currencies, and I prefer any stable currencies above a bank account. So I prefer hedging my Bitcoins into a stable currency instead of a bank account, because it's just more easy. And I love that these stable currencies are making it easy to onboard Bitcoin and many other cryptocurrencies. But there is a very big but. Please understand that these stable currencies, the whole DeFi industry, is KYC, it's regulated. Please also understand that all these stable currencies are run and started by centralized organizations, which means they can freeze your wallet. As we have seen a few days ago, USDC, the stable currency, froze an address that contained $100,000 worth of USDC. So they blacklisted this address, which means it's frozen. He cannot access his. So the guy that holds $100,000 in a stable currency in this address cannot use them anymore. He cannot access anymore because it's blacklisted, it's frozen. This shows you why I like Bitcoin and I prefer Bitcoin above all the other currencies, because it is decentralized, immutable, it's unconfiscatable. Nobody can take your Bitcoin, nobody can freeze your Bitcoin, as long you take care of your private keys. You are the only one that can freeze your Bitcoin. That's why I made this Bob Marley slogan into a Bitcoin slogan. Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. If you take this one and translate this one to crypto, then you would make emancipate yourself from financial slavery. None but ourselves can freeze our Bitcoins. So it is very important to understand that US dollar Tether, USDC, they can all freeze your addresses. US dollar Tether has done it till now 39 times. So it's a really small chance they will freeze your address, because of the 1.5 million addresses, only 39 were frozen. So that's a 0.002% of chance that they will freeze your address. So it's like almost nothing. And USDC only froze one address till now with $100,000. Out of the 180,000 USDC addresses, only freeze one is a 0.0002% chance of that your address has been frozen. Yes, I understand the chance is really small, but there is a chance. This is the thing that bothers me and why I support Bitcoin to the fullest. When it is possible to freeze your capital, and yes, even if the chance is like 0.0001%, it is possible. So if they need to do it, they will do it, because these guys were now forced by law. The law forced them to blacklist and freeze this address containing $100,000 worth of USDC. So this is scary, because all these centralized organizations are still obeying the law. And I don't blame them, but I just want to warn you, don't think that if you have stable currencies, that is the same as a cryptocurrency like Bitcoin. Stable currencies are beautiful, the industry is growing, but it's not a cryptocurrency like Bitcoin. Stable currencies can be frozen, Bitcoin cannot be frozen. Very important to remember, guys. Please, that is the reason why you must never have all your capital in stable currencies or on exchanges or on custodial wallets. Keep it on non-custodial wallets. Keep your cryptos at a place where you have access to your private keys. Hardware wallets, non-custodial software wallets, all these kinds of wallets where you have access to your private keys. Then it is your capital. Not your keys, not your Bitcoin. One more thing I want to speak to you guys about today. I want to educate you a little bit about fungible and non-fungible tokens, because you hear these phrases many times now in the news and you read it everywhere. They are always talking about a fungible token or a non-fungible token. I just shortly want to tell you what the difference is, so that every time I will mention it in my videos, you will understand what I'm talking about. A fungible token is a token like the dollar, like the euro, like Bitcoin. It doesn't matter which Bitcoin you have, it doesn't matter which dollar you own, it doesn't matter which euro you own. It just matters that you have only the quantity of what you own matters. If I pay a euro in a store, they won't ask me which euro is this. If I pay with Bitcoin in the store, they don't ask me which Bitcoin is this. Sometimes they do, because they want to see that it's not an illegally used or created Bitcoin, I think. They still think that Bitcoin is a scam, some people in the world. But that's a fungible token. The only two key factors of a fungible token is that the quantity and the ownership. It doesn't matter which one it is, it just matters that you own it and how much you own of them. So how many Bitcoins, how many euros, how many dollars, it doesn't matter which Bitcoin, which euro or which dollar. You will be only always able to transact it. Non-fungible tokens are completely the opposite. Here it matters what you are owning. For example, a non-fungible token is a house. If you give a house as a present to your wife for her wedding day, she will probably ask you which house. Because not all the houses are the same. Every house is unique. Even houses that are built in a community are unique. They have a different kitchen, or they have a different garden, or they have whatever that's different. It's a unique house. This is an example of a non-fungible token. Did you ever collect these soccer or these football play cards or baseball play cards? Non-fungible tokens. Especially when there is an autograph of one of the players on this card, it's a very unique card. This is a non-fungible token. Even something more common, a receipt. When you pay at a store, you receive a receipt. This is a unique receipt. It only accounts for the things you bought with a unique number of the receipt, a unique transaction number. This we would call in our industry a non-fungible token, because nobody will receive the same, exactly same receipt as you are. It's a unique receipt. So if you look at this industry, fungible, non-fungible, the non-fungible industry part is growing very fast. Let's take this last example of the receipts. Millions of people go to stores every day and we get a paper receipt. Yes, we have been trying to minimize the amount of receipts, but we are still giving them out, handing them out, and everybody's throwing them away. Waste of paper, waste of everything else. If you would replace these receipts with a non-fungible token on the blockchain, we already have a huge solution for all this overused amount of paper. Every time I go to the 7-Eleven, I buy something, and I pay with my Bitcoins in the wallet, I receive a non-fungible token in my wallet that I'm the owner of the thing I bought in the store. So I don't need the receipt anymore for guarantee or for a proof or to exchange it again and back in the store if I bought the wrong clothes or whatever, you know, because now I have this digital copy of this receipt, a non-fungible token, in my wallet. When I go to the store back to exchange the goods, I can just show them this token. So this is one example of non-fungible tokens. Same as with houses. If you buy a house, you get a deed. Why would we still pay so much money for these deeds and all that stuff when it could be a simple, simple transaction on the blockchain? I buy a house, this is registered on the blockchain, a non-fungible token is created that I'm the real owner of this house. Finished. As long as I hodl this non-fungible token, I am the owner. And it's not only with houses, you can do this to many, many other things in the world. So this is a very, very important difference between fungible and non-fungible. And you will hear me talking a little bit more often about these things to explain you the difference between all the projects in this beautiful industry of blockchain and Bitcoin. If you like today's video, guys, give it a thumbs up, share it with your friends. Please subscribe to our channel and hit the notification bell so you'll be notified on every new video I make. And if you're up to it, leave a comment, because I love to reply to your comments. Thank you for watching. I wish you an amazing day, and I'll see you tomorrow again. Bye.